Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Maria Schitzer-Coburn, and it's my pleasure on behalf of USC Libraries and Special Collections to welcome you to tonight's event, the 17th Annual Ruskin Lecture, which will be presented by Dr. Professor Atwood. USC Libraries is pleased to host again this year the annual Ruskin Lecture, which is organized by LA's prestigious Ruskin Art Club. Since 2014, the libraries is very proud to be the home of the Ruskin Art Club archives, which records the historic records of this very illustrious cultural institution. It is the oldest in Los Angeles, and it was founded in October of 1888, so a very long, rich career. And if you haven't had a chance to go down to Special Collections, which is just down the hall in room 206, we have materials set out from the club's records, books, and materials that give you a really good sense of Ruskin and also the doings of the club. So I think you will enjoy that treat if you haven't already had an opportunity. Before we get started, I want to thank my colleagues here in the libraries, Tyson Gaskell and Patty Johnson, for their help putting this event on, as well as my colleague Sue Lufshine, who put together the display and also processed the materials in the archive. So she's quite knowledgeable about our collection. Again, now it's my pleasure to pass this on to the executive director of the Ruskin Art Club, Gabriel Mayer, who then will officially get the program underway. And so thank you again for coming.
There's nothing semi-official about what Mario just said. It's all official. I too want to welcome you to the 17th annual Ruskin Lecture, our second, as Maria said, here at USC. This annual lecture does two things. It inaugurates the Ruskin Art Club's season, a season of lectures and special events that goes throughout the year. So this is kind of our inaugural event. But more importantly, it gives us an annual chance to do in public what we do as an organization. As an organization, we're dedicated to exploring in all sorts of ways, including in our own lives, what ramifications the teachings of the art and social critic John Ruskin might have to our challenges in the 21st century. But this lecture gives us an opportunity to do this publicly, to have a public opportunity to talk about a major issue that we're all concerned about in the 21st century, and to reflect on what John Ruskin's teachings might be saying to us in that area. I can hardly say that nothing would be more timely or more appropriate to be doing here at USC than to have a lecture on education and about the nature and purposes of education, about which Ruskin has so many remarkable things to say. Let me also, as Maria said, the Ruskin Art Club is Los Angeles' oldest cultural and arts association. We occasionally get challenged by other associations, which date back to this early period, but I think it's safe to say that we can claim to be Los Angeles' oldest cultural association if we can't quite pass muster with all of Pasadena's cultural associations. But the club is really, as a number of other organizations and enterprises are, is a living exemplar of that Ruskin movement that began at the end of the 19th century and beginning of the 20th century, that had such an effect on Southern California, Southern California thought, architecture, ideals, you name it. So we're very privileged to be a living continuation of that discussion and that interaction, that dialogue, we might say, between the remarkable ideas of one of the most remarkable thinkers ever, but certainly one of the great thinkers of the 19th century. Those ideas on the issues and problems we face in Southern California. So we're always very delighted to have this opportunity, not only to have a lecture, but to have a discussion, hopefully, where we can begin to share and explore ourselves and personally some of these aspects. So without further ado, I wanted to note that the last year's lecture given by Clive Wilmer, who is the master of the Guild of St. George, and the person I'm turning this over to will tell you a little more about that. Ruskin's Language, How a Victorian Prophet Uses Words, a remarkable, even I would say revelatory, lecture. Copies of this are now available. So we always publish the Ruskin lectures. So last year's lecture is now available. And also, I wanted to note, please take your letterpress copy of the program with you. This is just part of a way of saying how special an occasion this is for us. So, without further ado, let me introduce Professor Jim Spates, a dear friend, a Ruskin scholar, a professor at Hobart and William Smith Colleges in Geneva, and a companion of the Guild of St. George. A number of us are proud to share that title with Jim. And he's going to speak a little bit and then introduce our speaker. Jim.
Well, it's a delight to see everybody tonight. I learn more every time I'm here about the eminent history of the Ruskin Art Club. And Ruskin died in 1900. It had just turned the new century. And already there were groups like the Ruskin Art Club here in Los Angeles. There were other organizations in England, as you might imagine, and in New York as well, who were honoring him for the great work that he did. And yet today, Ruskin is not a name that comes trippingly off the tongue for many of us. You all remember Charles Dickens? You all remember William Gladstone? You all remember William Wordsworth? You all remember all sorts of wonderful people in the great British 19th century, but it's often the case that lots of people do not remember John Ruskin. I think there are complex and important reasons for this, but during Ruskin's life, this is no exaggeration, Ruskin was as famous as any of the people I just mentioned. His books sold to by the dozens, the hundreds of dozens, to all sorts of people who loved great ideas and thoughts. He took England by storm in his early years, in his 20s, by writing a series of books called Modern Painters. Briefly about that. Ruskin grew up loving nature. He grew up then loving art, loving a particular painter, J.M.W. Turner. Turner, I don't think there's a British art critic in the world today who would not say that Turner is England's greatest painter. And Ruskin would say he was not only England's greatest painter, he was the greatest landscape painter who ever lived. And so when Ruskin was a young boy in his teens, he saw what Turner was painting, he loved what Turner was painting, he thought this was a true evocation of what nature in its essence and its beauties was all about. And then he started reading the press, and he found that many of the critics of Turner's work, because each painter's new works would be published, would be brought every year to a central place and be evaluated. Turner was being slandered, Ruskin thought. No one got it. No one saw how fantastic, how beautiful, how important, what an incredible person this Turner was. And so he decided to write a book. And he was only 24 at the time, and he wrote a book called Modern Painters that later on stretched to 5 volumes. He had a lot to say about Turner. But the burden of the book was to show that Turner was the greatest painter living, and the way in which he did it is beautiful. And if you go to England, you know you can still do a lot of this. You can take Ruskin's book and walk around, because many of the paintings that he used as examples are still hanging in galleries around London. And you can take the book and look at the paintings and see what Ruskin is trying to do. He's trying to show you, Claude Lorrain does this. Okay, now look at how Turner does it. He does it better, don't you think? He says, Gainsborough does this. We love Gainsborough. But now, look at how Ruskin does this. He does it better, don't you think? And so he walks you through, the burden of the book is to show you that in the end, that Turner is an astonishingly great, underappreciated painter. And then he went on to write 2, 3, 4, 5 volumes of modern painters, all about art at the time, became the most famous art critic of the age. His prose was legendary. People loved reading Ruskin because his images were astonishing. If we had time, I'm sure Sara will share one or two of these with you tonight. He was a writer nonpareil. He just was able to put words together in a way that fascinated you. So he wrote on art and architecture throughout the 1840s and the 1850s, has an incredible book, a three-volume book called The Stones of Venice, where he tries to show why Venice rose, how it prospered, and how it fell. And you could see it all in The Stones of Venice. You could see it all in the remnants of these different periods. It's an incredible piece of work. But by the late 1850s, Ruskin had become convinced that his work had failed, that all his work, and it was all dedicated to getting people to love nature and to understand how beautiful this world is in which we live, and to get them to learn how to take care of it, because it was beginning to fall apart under all the negative things that were happening as a result of the Industrial Revolution. Compared to then, all the things that have happened since. But he tried to get people to see these things, and he thought, they love my words, but they don't get my message. So around 1858, 59, 1860, he has a radical change in his life, and the second phase of his writing life begins, and he starts to write, I'm a sociologist, and that's how I got interested in Ruskin. He starts to write essentially sociology, and he takes on the Industrial Revolution and laissez-faire capitalism directly, and basically says, look, you folks are exploiting the land, you're exploiting the people who work for you, you're turning the world into a morass of smoke and pollution, and you don't care and you don't understand, and I'm going to try to get you to stop. And those books, that second phase of his life, the second phase of his writing life, fell on not deaf ears, but outraged ears. And because when Ruskin started to publish his sociological critiques, he called it political economy, he was vilified. The same people who loved him and said, oh, you're the greatest writer we've ever read, Ruskin, hated him now. And he lost so much of his following. He didn't give up a moment. He kept writing throughout the 1860s, in effect, treatise after treatise, essay after essay, gave lecture after lecture, trying to get his contemporaries to come to grips with how they were despoiling the earth, how they were ruining the very place that gave us sustenance. Well, they didn't like it. And by the end of the 1860s, I'm just kind of giving you a brief overview of Ruskin's career. By the end of the 1860s, he said, well, they're not listening to that either. They're reading me, but they're not getting that, or they don't want to hear what I'm saying. He says, so as a result of that, I understand, and this is now becomes the next major phase in his life. He says, I understand that it is not the saying, but it is the doing that matters. If they won't do it, I'll do it. So he establishes an organization, first called the St. George's Company in the early 1870s, not long after called the Guild of St. George, which Gabriel mentioned a moment ago. And the Guild of St. George is dedicated to essentially getting a group of people together, like us, who care about the earth, who care about life, who care about each other, who understand that life is a gift and that it's our job as human beings to preserve it. So he gets these, he wants to get a group of people together. They will live off the land. They'll live what we would say organically. They will not pollute the land. They'll take care of each other. They'll bring up their children together, and they'll educate each other to the things that are the most valuable in life. So that's the beginning of the Guild of St. George. Ruskin was the first master of the Guild of St. George. Last year, if you were here, you heard the current master of the Guild of St. George, Clive Wilmer, give a wonderful lecture on Ruskin's language. And so that becomes the next part of his legacy, to try to set up a way in which people should actually go out and do to make the change, to be the change that you want. That it has to be done. You can't just say it. You can't just say it even beautifully. You have to have people who get out there and say, right, I'm going to make it happen as well. Last part of his life, he is very depressed, because even then he feels that he's failed, that he hasn't accomplished the things that he has wanted. The last decade of his life is really, he's very quiet. He's quite sad. I believe that he has periods of madness that he goes in and out of, gets better, goes in and out of. But I'm deeply convinced that the reason that he does this is, or this happens to him, is that he just thinks he's expended 50 years of effort and nobody really got it. So that's sort of a brief nutshell of what Ruskin is tried to do in the course of his life over all this time. At the core of everything he tried to do was this notion of education. Why don't we understand these essential things about living and how to live well together? And he said, what we have to do is we have to educate people to understand the preciousness that is life, the goodness that is the earth, and how we are all integrally involved in it together. So that was his essential purpose. So work after work after work has this idea of the centrality of education to people's lives. And that's what Sara Atwood is going to talk about tonight. So I'm delighted to introduce her. She is a wonderful younger Ruskin scholar who's making an amazing mark in terms of her work on Ruskin. And she's published in many journals. Among them, she's published in the 19th Century Prose, the Journal of Pre-Raphaelite Studies, Carlisle Studies Annual, Earthlines. She's got a great book, and if you want to get her book, we have flyers over there that will allow you to order her book at the end of the hour, called Ruskin's Educational Ideals. This talk is based on her insights from that book. She's organized symposia in Berkeley. She's organized symposia in England on Ruskin. So we're very delighted to have her with us tonight. She's a companion of the Guild of St. George, like another of us, a number of us here tonight. And she's working on a book on Ruskin and nature, and she's got two or three major articles still in preparation. So, on education and Ruskin, Sara Atwood, welcome. We're glad to have you with us.
Thank you, Jim. It was a very generous introduction, as always. Thank you very much. I'd also like to thank Gabriel Meyer and the Ruskin Art Club for inviting me to give this lecture, which is an honor to be here, and for their generosity in hosting me here in LA. And I'd like to thank USC for hosting this event as well, and everyone in Special Collections. I was just in there looking at the exhibition, which is really remarkable. These are objects I haven't seen before myself, so it was very exciting to see what the Ruskin Art Club has, to see it displayed so nicely as well. So thank you for that. So as Jim introduced, I'm going to be speaking about Ruskin and education today. And what I want to do is to bring Ruskin's ideas and his principles in line with what we're talking about in the modern world. I know that Ruskin was talking about many of the same issues that we continue to talk about today with regard to education, the environment, the economy. But at the base of all this is education, because it was key to everything that he taught, as Jim mentioned already. And so I'm talking today about valuing education in a market society. And I want to start with a story about my own life. When I lived in Arizona, and I just moved recently, last year, from Arizona to Portland, Oregon, when I lived there, one of my favorite running routes took me by the neighborhood middle school. And once a year, large notice board outside the school would proudly announce that our students read 1 million words this year. And every time I saw this message, I would feel uneasy, and my adrenaline would always kind of shoot up. I'd run a little bit faster. 1 million words, I used to think. But were they words worth reading? Were they words worth remembering? Were they read thoughtfully or in a rush to reach the million word goal? Was their message understood? And what does a tally like this have to do with reading, rightly understood, at all? As Ruskin warned readers in 1864, you might read all the books in the British Library and remain an utterly illiterate, uneducated person. But if you read 10 pages of a good book, letter by letter, that is to say, with real accuracy, you are forevermore, in some measure, an educated person. The entire difference between education and non-education, as regards the merely intellectual part of it, consists in this accuracy. And I would argue that despite the considerable amount of time and energy and argument devoted to educational problems, we have a lot still to learn about the nature of good education and the right way to achieve it. We consult dubious experts, even more dubious politicians. We pore over statistics and test results, and we jump eagerly on the latest technology bandwagon. In an age that champions the notion of more, I would say we've extended this axiom to education. More testing, more measuring, more hours in the school day, more standardization, more alternative schools, more specialization, but significantly fewer periods of recess and less emphasis on the fine arts, All of this is complicated, it's controversial, and it's costly. And none of it has succeeded in loosening the Gordian knot of problems in our schools. But it's arguable that our educational problems, as well as our failure to solve them, are linked to a readiness to adapt market strategies to education, and also to adapt market attitudes and language as well. Our long immersion in market values and faith in what Ruskin calls the goddess of getting on has significantly altered our understanding of education. And for Ruskin, education meant, above all, teaching people to look closely at the world and to see it clearly. Sight was for him an essentially spiritual faculty connected with wisdom and understanding. The main thing which we ought to teach our youth to see is to see something, he declared. All that the eyes which God has given them are capable of seeing. For Ruskin, education wasn't a commodity, but a transformative, life-enhancing process founded on what he called the law of help. And this law is the defining characteristic of his work. It underlies his entire teaching and all his worldview. And it describes the interdependence of all things, in art, in nature, and in society. The highest and first law of the universe, and the other name of life, he wrote, is therefore help. The other name of death is separation. Government and cooperation are in all things and eternally the laws of life. Anarchy and competition, eternally and in all things, the laws of death. So the extension of market principles to education was particularly repulsive to Ruskin. And the 1860s was the era of Robert Lowe's revised code with its program of payment by results. And this is a system that we've revived in our own day, and we've had similarly dreary results from it. Maintaining that this system would help to control public expenditure on education, Lowe famously declared that if it is not cheap, it shall be efficient. If it is not efficient, it shall be cheap. And for his part, Ruskin exclaimed, "I hear strange talk continually, how difficult it is to make people pay for education. Why, I should think so. Do you make your children pay for their education, or do you give it to them compulsorily and gratis? You do not expect them to pay you for their teaching, except by becoming good children. Why should you expect a peasant to pay for his, except by becoming a good man? Payment enough, I think, if we knew it, payment enough to himself as to us. You do not learn that you may live, you live that you may learn." So you can guess, just from what I've said already about Ruskin, of what he might think of the million-word challenge that I mentioned at the start of this talk. And to be fair, a challenge like this has its heart in the right place. It seeks to promote the power of reading and to encourage children to read and for families to foster their children's love of reading outside of school. So my criticism of it may seem a little bit cranky. Surely a program that's focused on the value of reading must be worthwhile. And to the extent that it fires a love of reading and of books in the children who participate in it, it may be. Although one administrator's claim that students' enthusiasm and aptitude for reading is improved by exposure to books, any books, gives me a little bit of cause for doubt. We've all heard of this kind of thing before. At least he's reading, someone says, of the child with his nose buried in Walter the Farting Dog. This is rather like saying, of the child who's having chips and soda for lunch, at least he's eating. Which, given the state of children's nutrition in the US, and in our schools in particular, is far from being the stuff of analogy. But an unmixed diet of ephemeral language and ideas, intellectual chips and soda, if you will, won't nourish the mind. Ruskin rejected outright the common plea that anything does to exercise the mind upon. He declared that this is an utterly false idea. The human soul, he said, in youth, is not a machine of which you can polish the cogs with any kelp or brick dust near at hand. And having got it into working order, in good, empty, and oiled serviceableness, start your immortal locomotive at 25 years old or 30. The whole period of youth is one essentially of formation, edification, instruction. I use the words with their weight in them. Intaking of stores, establishment of vital habits, hopes, and faiths. There is not an hour of it but is trembling with destinies, not a moment of which, once past, the appointed work can ever be done again, or the neglected blow struck on the cold iron. So the notion that focusing primarily on accessible books will make children into readers is yet one more example of our short-sightedness, our tendency to value means over ends. After all, a desirable end may perish forever in the wrong means. And this isn't to say that all accessible or popular books are useless or unworthy. Some of them are very enjoyable. Many children are drawn to this sort of book, and it's impossible to predict what particular kind of book will fire a child's love of reading. But the trouble occurs when educators fail to encourage students to diversify their reading with unfamiliar or more challenging texts. In fact, recent US studies have shown that instead of moving on to works of greater complexity, students tend to get stuck at a low level of reading. The result is too often reflected in the curriculum. In 2012, the average complexity of texts assigned to high school students in the US was around the sixth grade level. And naturally, the Million Words program will be largely dependent upon the approach of individual schools, teachers, administrators, students, parents, most of whom care deeply. But the program nonetheless reflects general educational trends. Note the competitive structure, which includes a reward, a gift certificate, for those who reach their goal. There's a reading meter at the program's website, which allows participants to monitor how many books their classmates are reading, as well as to, quote, see how your school is doing compared to other schools. It's neat to come in here and tell friends to look at your name on the screen, says one eighth grader. And one wonders what actually motivates these word-hungry students. We speak of education today, as in Ruskin's time, as a means of improving our prospects or advancing in life. Ruskin argues that too often, advancement in life means becoming conspicuous in life. Not the accomplishment of any great aim, but the being seen to have accomplished it. In a word, we mean the gratification of our thirst for applause. For today's Facebook generation, this thirst is both amply stimulated and easily quenched, in school now as well as online. And it's worth noting that the language of competition pervades education reform efforts, even at the highest levels. The White House's current reform initiative is called Race to the Top. And this name has little to do with education, but everything to do with competitive, rapid, and aggressive market imperatives. The program's website announces that to prepare Americans for the jobs of the future and help restore middle-class security, we have to out-educate the world. And that starts with a strong school system. It goes on to declare that the strength of the American economy is inextricably linked to the strength of America's education system. America's ability to compete begins each day in classrooms across the nation. And there's nothing here about the importance of education to say good governance, citizenship, social justice, domestic happiness, community, stewardship, or peace. All have been subordinated to the marketplace, civitas swallowed up in the forum. In the wry lines of the poet Arthur Hugh Clough, thou shalt not covet, but tradition approves all forms of competition. The writer, poet, farmer, Wendell Berry, argues that modern education is aimed not at cultivating humanity, but at making a specialist, a careerist, a graduate. In industrial education, he says, the thing finally made is of no concern to the makers. And I would say that this manufacturing approach is strikingly apparent in talk about squeezing an additional half-hour enrichment lesson into the school day, extending the school day, adding after-school classes, and cutting out time-wasting during the day. And usually by time-wasting, what is meant is recess, the arts, or physical education. In this context, children become generic units to be processed. Their developmental needs and individuality are forgotten in a competitive frenzy. As Sir Ken Robinson urges, we have to recognize that human flourishing is not a mechanical process, it's an organic process. And you cannot predict the outcome of human development. All you can do, like a farmer, is create the conditions under which they will flourish. Now, in recent years, some schools have taken this competition and reward model even further by introducing incentive programs, including cash payouts, either for grades or for the number of books read. And of course, some parents reward their children for good grades to begin with. They do this at home. Yet the practice takes on new meaning when it's endorsed by the school. This sort of extrinsic motivation, which mirrors corporate incentive programs, can erode intrinsic motivation. The long-term effects of this can be damaging. As Harvard political philosopher Michael J. Sandel observes, markets leave their mark. Students who are urged to seek reward primarily for themselves are certainly not learning anything about the law of help and the responsibility and mutuality that it implies. But they are being taught to internalize the logic of the socio-political system under which they live. Last year, I asked my first-year composition students, and these are 19, 20-year-olds, to write an essay arguing either for or against cash incentives for grades or reading. Roughly two-thirds of my students argued in favor of the idea, explaining all kids want money, and testifying that they themselves would work harder if payment were at stake. And I was dismayed to find some of them explaining further that as school is a young person's job, it's only fair and logical that payment should be offered for good performance. This practice, they maintained, would help to prepare young people for the real world, whatever that might be. It's a phrase I hear a lot. I'm never quite sure what it means. In discussion with them revealed that a majority of them consider education primarily a means to employment and a desirable standard of living. And this isn't unreasonable, but what struck me was the general sense that this is all that education should be. In likening education to a job, and this is a common analogy that I hear a lot, not just from students, but from adults as well, that school is a child's job, they were perhaps unwittingly expressing what they saw as education's joylessness and drudgery, its clock-punching, purely utilitarian necessity. The college degree was one more box to be ticked, one more hoop to jump through. Like Wendell Berry, who is one of our modern wise men and knows his Ruskin, I see the economy teaching my students to give themselves a price before they can give themselves a value. A growing number of students seem to have accepted that the sole purpose of their education is ultimately to become good employees. Consider also the incursion of corporate speak into educational contexts. The UK writer and educational campaigner Melissa Benn has written about the prevalence in modern education of the familiar deadening language and acronyms of the market, where a lesson is not a lesson, but an education input. Creating a better school system becomes a question of system, scale, and replicability, and good ideas put into action by inventive people become outcome-focused commissioning arrangements rather than input-driven procurements. That's tongue twister even to read that quote to you. The Chancellor of Arizona State University, Michael Crow, once gave an NPR interview that I thought perfectly, if chillingly, expressed this market-centered position. He repeatedly referred to outcomes, impacts, people products, learning environments, and platforms. And he confidently declared that we can speed up learning and intensify learning at the same time by using technology that allows us to do this. A book by itself is a passive thing, he helpfully explained, requiring the intervention of professors and technology to be made useful. And all this is a far cry from Ruskin's notion of the best books as what he called King's Treasuries. Language like Crow's offers an arid view of education, to say the least. It's the view inevitably produced by the doctrine that the purpose of education is the mass production of producers and consumers. And I would say that such language doesn't just express our market-centered approach to education, but it perpetuates that approach, language conditioning practice. To rephrase the writer Michael Pollan, it makes all the difference to both students and teachers if one conceives of school as a manufacturing facility. As Ruskin recognized in Unto This Last, when all relations are those of exchange, we forget how to value what properly matters, including education. And the current emphasis on STEM learning and the simultaneous devaluation of the humanities and fine arts is driven by these same market imperatives. This is not to say that science, technology, engineering, and math are not valuable and important subjects of study, because they clearly are for a number of reasons. But their present elevation springs from the conviction that these fields are the primary route to competitive economic success. Yet to separate these subjects from the humanities is to impose an artificial and false division, because the various branches of learning are necessarily interrelated, which is something that Ruskin recognized from the start. Criticizing the growing professionalization of his own day, Ruskin described how, with increasingly evil results to all of us, the separation is every day widening between the man of science and the artist. Today, specialization has increased to a point at which we are in danger of graduating students whose knowledge of the world and effectiveness in it is hobbled by a narrow frame of reference. As the 2013 report of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences makes clear, evidence of the particular needs of the humanities and social sciences now reaches us from every sector. Parents are not reading to their children as frequently as they once did. Humanities teachers, particularly in K-12 history, are even less well-trained than teachers of STEM subjects. And funding to support international education has been cut by 41% in 4 years. At the very moment when China and some European nations are seeking to replicate our model of broad education in the humanities, social sciences, and natural sciences, we are instead narrowing our focus and abandoning our sense of what education has been and should continue to be. And that report was called The Heart of the Matter from the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. It's a long quote from that report. This neglect of the humanities has been evident in the students that I've taught at the colleges that were both 2- and 4-year schools in New York, Georgia, and Arizona. And now I'm in Portland, and so far I've been encouraged by a better level of preparedness and intellectual curiosity. But it's early days, hoping that will last. We'll see. But throughout nearly all my years of teaching, students have regularly arrived in my class with a poor grasp of English grammar and syntax, scanty knowledge of art, literature, and history, and an inability to express themselves clearly outside the personal essay or to draw connections between ideas. Aside from a few exceptions each term, they're generally either unwilling or unable to engage in discussions, and they seem to have no sense of the larger cultural or historical narrative. It's often just as George Orwell described in Politics in the English Language. The writer either has a meaning and cannot express it, or he inadvertently says something else, or he is almost indifferent as to whether his words mean anything or not. And these students are not unintelligent people. Yet not having been taught to think or to use language effectively, they have been rendered dumb. They have also been left defenseless against the slick, potted language of the market by which they are assailed relentlessly and daily, and the language of pop culture as well. Ruskin would have called this the universal gabble of fools and of the flocks which follow them. And what's more, my students' work has too often borne the marks of our self-esteem culture. Rather than being encouraged to recognize their limitations as well as their strengths, students today are applauded so often and so energetically for their slightest efforts that they form an inflated sense of their abilities. It's not unusual to find a student declaring, as one of mine did after reading Darwin's Origin of Species, that Darwin and I both had different ideas about evolution, but I also agreed with some of his theories. And one can imagine Darwin's shade heaving a sigh of relief. Or to read the supremely self-confident verdict that C.S. Lewis has done a great job writing the abolition of man. And note the use of the bland adjective great there. It's lost all meaning through indiscriminate usage. Language is also a sad casualty of market-centered, assessment-driven education. Orwell observed that the whole tendency of modern prose is away from concreteness. Today it seems fair to expand this and say that the whole tendency of modern education is toward abstraction and away from sight and understanding. During one term, recent term, a student who had earned a C in my class and was frankly lucky to have done so, sent me a fairly typical email inquiring in unpunctuated, uncapitalized sentences why I had given him only a C. This young man had been consistently late to class, he had accrued many absences, and he had never spoken a word in discussion. But he took issue with the scant points he'd earned for participation. He didn't understand this because he said that he'd read all the readings, written all the papers, and shown up for class. He couldn't conceive that meeting the barest minimum of requirements hadn't earned him an A, or at least a B. As he likely saw it, he had dutifully punched the clock, and I had denied him his wages. The notion that he might have reaped a greater reward by going beyond the minimum didn't have seemed to occur to him at all. And too often I find that students are motivated less by intellectual curiosity than by an overriding obsession with grades, which they see more and more with a profound sense of entitlement to consider as a reward that I should bestow. Sometimes we'll be talking about something in class, we'll be having a discussion about a paper or something that they're working on, and they're not so concerned with the subject matter of the paper, but with the grading rubric. There's a real focus on what the grading will be like, what the outcome will be, rather than on the work that goes into the project. But my students are likable people. I always enjoy them. They're respectful, they're polite, they're funny, but they've been treated as educational consumers, and they've come to consider education as yet one more transaction. It's also likely that a number of them either don't want to be or shouldn't be in college. Our understanding of advancement in life has changed little since Ruskin's day. We still promote an education befitting such and such a station in life, by which we emphatically do not mean a life of supposedly lowly manual labor, handwork, or craft. In fact, most students no longer even learn the sort of practical skills that were once taught in home ec or shop classes. The result, according to one commentator, is a generation of students that can answer questions on standardized tests and know factoids, but can't do anything. A student blogger for the Guardian newspaper in the UK has written that besides what we need to know for our own jobs, we have little call for practical skills. We don't grow our own crops, build our own houses, or make our own clothes anymore. We simply buy these things. Unable to create anything ourselves, what we have mastered instead is consumption. Ruskin said that his teaching at the Working Men's College was directed not at making a carpenter an artist, but to making him happier as a carpenter. Where Ruskin found dignity in manual labor, we see it as something to avoid, the resort of those who have failed to progress up the social ladder. Wendell Berry argues that the root of this cultural antipathy to so-called drudgery is the pseudo-aristocratic notion that one is too good for the fundamental and recurring tasks of domestic order and biological necessity. To dirty one's hand in the soil or submerge them for very long in soapy water is degrading and brutalizing. Far from seeking to make the carpenter happy as a carpenter, we prefer that he should be an executive. And the irony here, of course, is that those fundamental and recurring tasks that Berry spoke about lie at the heart of the Greek economia. In an educational environment so intensely focused on conventional economic success, young people whose talents lie outside of academia and whose inmost aspirations are unsympathetic to the corporate world aren't given much encouragement to pursue a different path. A controversial 2013 Brookings Institute report titled "Should Everyone Go to College?" finds that there are many non-monetary benefits of schooling which are harder to measure but no less important. And it's heartening to find this point being made, but so pervasive is the market view of education that even this trend-bucking report abounds in economic jargon, analyzing the rate of return and cost-benefit ratio of a university education and graphing earnings trajectories. The report remains a long way from recognizing what Ruskin expressed so clearly, that there may be an education which in itself is advancement in life, and that any other than that may perhaps be advancement in death. Ruskin equated wealth with life, and he believed that the purpose of true education was to teach nations and people to desire and labor for the things that lead to life. Of course, life, in Ruskin's sense of the cultivation of soul, morals, and mind, is not measurable. It can't be assessed, tested, or defined. There is no wealth but life, Ruskin said. Yet for us, as for 19th century society, wealth is material and monetary. Our market model of education is predicated upon preparing young people not to share, sustain, and enhance the things that lead to life, but to become specialized servants of the economy, mere functionaries. Is education possibly a process of trading awareness for things of lesser worth, wondered the American conservationist Aldo Leopold in 1948. The goose who trades his is soon a pile of feathers. Our confusion about the true value of education leaves us deeply vulnerable. There's undoubtedly a connection between education and economic success. People do have to get a job when they leave university. But wisdom, wealth, and learning are not merely exponents of the economy. And as Leopold put it, perception cannot be purchased with either learned degrees or dollars. Education subordinated to economic consideration becomes simply the sort of training intended to make students efficient integers of the economy, producers and consumers who will participate in and perpetuate the culture of more. For those of us who believe with Ruskin that education is leading human souls to what is best and making what is best out of them, the question is what sort of society we ought to have and what kind of education will best fit us to create it. Ruskin posited a human economy characterized by cooperation, social responsibility, mutuality, and all the spiritual and social ties implied by the Greek economia. His concept of life is drawn from a richness of experience generated by looking, drawing, thinking, reading, and doing. Souls of a good quality, Ruskin maintains, should be the end of all education. And this is culture in its primary sense of cultivation or development, a means of integrating into life a deep and multifaceted way of looking at the world. You must forget your money, Ruskin warned, and every other material interest, and educate for education's sake only, or the very good which you tried to bestow will become venomous, and you and your money will be lost together. And this has been the real cause of failure in our efforts for education hitherto, whether from above or below. There is no honest desire for the thing itself. And for all the frustrations of teaching, and I've mentioned several of them here, there are times when my efforts to help my students to see clearly succeed. My heart is lightened by the student who tells me that she had never heard about urban agriculture before, never seen a connection between food and social justice, but she's begun to think about it. Or the young man who writes that after a class spent in our college's community garden, he plans to start a small garden of his own. I'm encouraged by the quiet, seemingly unresponsive girl who remarks that our readings about nature have made her consider her own relationship to the natural world. And I'm moved by the thoughtful student who, despite deciding that Thoreau seems like he would be an unpleasant person, nonetheless concludes that Walden has taught her something which will resonate throughout her life, the idea that it's possible to live with less. And small victories like these are what draw teachers back to the classroom every year. In directing the focus to purely utilitarian outcomes, market-based education inures young people to a competitive, acquisitive culture. Yet what these successes tell me is that most young people can be brought to care about the things that lead to life, that they may well prefer an education that leads to a life-sustaining engagement with the world and with other people, an education that enables them both to envision and create the sort of wealth that can't be tracked on a balance sheet. And some of the principles that Ruskin articulated have by now become accepted practice. Many educators today recognize the value of engagement, hands-on, collaborative learning. Many schools are equipped with gardens, laboratories, and playgrounds. But extensive resources like these are rare at all but the wealthiest schools. And increasingly, hands-on education means using iPads and other technology, which for all their advantages, too often immerse students in a virtual environment, and they crowd out unmediated engagement with the real natural world. For the student who has taken a virtual hike through the Amazonian rainforest, planting seedlings in the school garden may seem a bit anticlimactic. And the child who's become used to controlling her virtual environment at a touch may be easily frustrated by activities that require time, care, and attention. Every semester, I show my students a number of paintings, and I project them on a screen in the classroom. And I'm glad that my classroom has the technology that allows me to do this. But when, instead of discussing the painting as I ask them to, some students whip out their phones and start Googling it, the point of the lesson is lost. It's not that the information that they find isn't without value. It's often very good information. It's often, accurate. But there's no effort and no thinking required to obtain it. What happens to curiosity, or wonder, or even healthy confusion when they can all be dispelled at the touch of a finger? The use of technology in the classroom is a complex and contested subject. It's another lecture entirely. But it's worth considering how, in altering the ways that we see, technology might also alter wisdom and understanding. There are many people who realize that things need to change. We hear about education reform all the time. But the educational establishment has become permeated by market interests. And in our market society, these interests trump all. While we continue to treat students as consumers, to subordinate education to economics, to perpetuate a self-esteem culture, to underfund arts programs and underrate the humanities, to encourage over-specialization, to focus myopically on testing and data-driven assessments and programs, and to promote competition and incentives, educational reform cannot succeed. We must first achieve a transformation in thinking. And as usual, that's the most difficult transformation of all. The modern world does not need more executives. It does need men and women capable of seeing clearly, governed by affection and fellowship, and well-fitted to work towards a better world than this. We are confronted with problems economic, environmental, educational, political, that can only be solved by people who have been so formed by their education as to understand that the law of help is not just a nice idea, but a true law. People whose motive power is not money, but soul. Educate or govern, Ruskin told his readers. They are one and the same word. You are to spend on national education and to be spent for it and to make by it not more money, but better men. They are to be your money's worth. Ruskin's ideas suggest new approaches to classroom instruction and practice and curricula, and we can undoubtedly benefit from these. But his methodology is crucially anchored by his vision of education as an ethical, transformative, communal process that leads not to economic or social advancement, but to an engagement with and respect for the world in all its richness, and to an understanding of our place in the order of things. And it's this vision that we'll need to adopt in order to create meaningful change. In doing so, it will be necessary to reject the linear vision of progress, which seeks rapid, measurable, and material ends in favor of the old cyclical vision of connection and cultivation. We have to recognize that there is more to a nation's success than global economic dominance, that the health of the natural world, the conditions and aims of our work, the strength of our communities, and the vitality of our cultural heritage are of greater importance. And if we attend to these things, if our education cultivates the reverence, care, and thoughtful attention necessary to attend to them, we can achieve success of a deeper and lasting kind. If we continue to ignore them, we risk ending up a pile of feathers. Thank you. Let me sit. Okay.
I just want to invite you all. You just heard a great talk on a critical subject. Questions on the floor? Sara will be glad to answer.
Okay.
Anybody? Oh, sure.
Give us a second.
Okay, give me a second.
Can you think of examples around the nation that sort of embody part of what you're suggesting as a model for education?
As a model for education?
Yeah, institutions that do it better than others.
I think that they're, because we have so many different types of school in this country, you know, we have charter schools, and we have private schools, and we have public schools, and we have all sorts of different schools. There's such a great difference from state to state, even from community to community, in what children have access to. And I think that there are schools that are doing these things, as I mentioned in the talk. There's some charter schools that are particularly taking these kinds of principles and enacting them and doing it successfully. There's some Waldorf schools that do a lot of the things that Ruskin advocated. Steiner had some similar ideas. They were very different in many ways, but he had some similar ideas. A lot of the Montessori schools do a lot of the hands-on learning, the active learning. I mean, it's not that it isn't happening anywhere. I don't mean to say that it's just not happening. But in the public school system, and that's the system we're always trying to reform and trying to fix, it's not happening in the way that it should. I think that that's a problem. And I think it's also a problem that there's such a great difference between the different schools.
Well, the schools you mentioned as successes, how do they avoid sort of the national market economy issue that you so clearly articulate?
Well, charter schools avoid it by not having to conform to the standard curriculum. And they can, because they have a charter, they can do their own thing. They can write up their own curriculum, and they usually, that's exactly what happens. I mean, my son went to a charter school in Arizona. It was a very traditional curriculum. It included, as you got into middle school, you know, Latin and Greek and seminar type classes, things like that, a lot of studio art and language, and those were all, you know, part of the curriculum. They weren't just extras. But that's because a charter school is independent. A private school is independent. They can do that as well. But the public schools don't have that leeway. And it's, you know, it really is the public schools I'm mostly focusing on here, because a lot of private and independent schools are already trying to do these things and succeeding. So.
One of the ways they've succeeded is that the parents mm-hmm. demand things. So
right.
What's going on in terms of educating parents of younger children so that they begin to demand these things as their children go through school?
Well, I think that parents largely self-educate themselves about what they want for their children, too. But you also, this also becomes a question of economics, doesn't it? Because there's, you know, some communities are going to have a lot better access to this kind of education. Some of the parents are going to know a lot more about what's happening in education and what they want for their children. And so you can end up with a situation, and we do, you know, where those who, you know, have more money and are better off economically can get this kind of education for their children, and those who aren't can't. And that's not right either. You know, there it shouldn't be that only, and this isn't an old problem, right? It shouldn't be that only some children can get access to this and others cannot. There are some charter schools, however, who are doing this in inner cities and succeeding well with it. So it's not that there's nothing in the inner cities either, but it's certainly not widespread.
So in the effort to educate and teach and talk and write about the ways How do you go about avoiding the rhetoric of sort of like the kids these days?
Yeah.
Rhetoric, and how do you acknowledge that it's not some sort of essential, what's in the water? Our 16-year-olds are not as smart as they used to be before, but that it's something that is that's what they've learned. How do you acknowledge that there's a problem while also,
well. I would say that it's the kids these days, it's the adults these days, right? It's the people who are designing the curricula, who are making the decisions about education. And so, the kids who are in school are just, following the program that they're being taught, right? So I think it's really the adults and the people who are involved in educational, planning and educational administration that we need to reach. And I gave a talk just yesterday to some students at the Levin Institute, and there were some really good questions afterward that brought this up. How do you make this sort of change happen? Because it's not easy. Obviously, Ruskin was talking about it in the 19th century. We're still talking about it today. We seem to have lost our vision of what education should be and what it means. And so we're not really sure what to do anymore, so we try a lot of different solutions, these Band-Aid solutions. Well, this hasn't worked, we'll try this. Well, Finland's doing really well, so let's do some of the things that the Finns do, completely disregarding the fact that their culture is very different. Society is more homogenous, it's a smaller country, lots of different factors. Let's just try that. For a while it was China that was doing interesting things, and we would take some of their strategies. But that's all just, as I said, it's applying a bandage to a problem. It's not fixing it from the roots up. But as far as back to your question, which I wandered from, how do you not just, put it all on the young people? I don't think that it's the students' fault. In some ways it is. In some ways, if there's like a lack of accountability that I see sometimes in students, or, a general lack of interest in, working hard at research or something, that may come from them. But I think that's also cultural. I don't think, we talk a lot about respecting education in this country, how we value it so highly, and then we don't do the things that show that we do. We talk about a good game, but then we don't actually practice it. And, if you live in a culture where education is only spoken about as something we respect, but that isn't enacted, then young people are going to pick up on that.
Yeah, I don't know how if there's going to be a shift, because I've been teaching all ages from 1982 until now, and I found that there was more and more of a push toward rote learning. So you're not just talking about, more advanced type of education. We're also talking about abstract thinking, and there seems to be less and less moving away from that. And I was really alarmed to hear a couple months ago one of the major universities here in Southern California is going to eliminate their English department because it doesn't lead to jobs.
Yes.
Yeah. And I found that incredibly frightening, and I don't know these trends, because as I said, I've been watching this since 1982, and I don't see how the trend is going to stop. There's a little bit of a backlash. You see that in films and various, certain art forms, you see there's more of a trend going back toward, let's say, humanity and passion, and various things that that seem to be devaluized, through technology, but I don't know how this trend is
going to change. Well, I have a teacher friend in Arizona who gets so frustrated because she teaches fourth grade, and she says, there's so much that I could do in my classroom, so many creative things I could do, she tells me, and yet I don't have time. She said, I'm so constrained by testing and assessment and the fact that we have to reach these, benchmarks in a certain amount of time that she can't, and she can't even slow down if a concept isn't being understood effectively. She can't slow down as much as she would like and really spend, say, a week on a concept that the students don't understand. She has to keep moving and do the best she can, within those parameters. She gets very frustrated by that, but she gets even more frustrated by, reformers who want to change the curriculum and make things better, but they don't really talk to the teachers or the students. Whenever there's an educational reform, there's some teachers that are invited to be part of the discussion, but I don't get the sense that those who are creating the reforms are spending a lot of time on the ground with teachers or with students. and really getting a sense of what it's like, you know, day to day to be a student or to be a teacher, you know, in this country.
I could give a little bit of a sociological perspective on it. It's not terribly enticing or uplifting. But you know, in a market economy, the job is to turn out worker bees. Mm. And you know, Sarah's really alluding to this, that and we heard it in the students yesterday that we talked to. They said, well, we'd love to take a course in
ceramics, she said.
Poetry, let's say, that we're really interested in, but we can't. Because if we do, we go off our track, and if we go off our track, then we're not going to get the degree we want. If we don't get that, we don't get the jobs. So they're caught in this terrible conundrum about where they sacrifice the things they might love and like for this market economy. We're worker bees. We've got to get out there. We've got to get a job. And truth be told, that's a real fear. And as we in our society have this increasing gap between those with money and those with law, that's a real terror for people who come from lower middle class, lower class backgrounds, that they're not going to get it at all.
But what I thought was interesting yesterday in our discussion was that one of the students who was there, she said that she would really like to take a class in ceramics, but she feels that that would be almost a luxury, and she really shouldn't take the time or spend the money on that when she has this degree program to follow. And I thought the way that she was talking about it was interesting, because the fact that we even think of a class like that as a luxury or an extra is part of the problem. You know, we're so conditioned to think of anything that does not lead to that, you know, career track, or we can, you know, go out and join the global economy as being, in some way, you know, a hobby rather than something serious. And I said that to her too. I said, do you realize that the language you're using to talk about it is part of what I've been talking about here? You know, the fact that even at my son is 11, even at his level in school, arts classes, physical education, music, those are called specials, and they're maybe once or twice a week. They're not part of the everyday curriculum, and they have this special designation. So we think that way as well, and that's, again, language that we use to talk about these things kind of, you know, perpetuates the way that we act.
Well, even convincing young parents and children in preschool that painting is a pre-reading skill because of the brain, and so that these physical activities are actually something that's very important part of the brain, and part of, so yeah, it's frustrating.
You had a question before.
Well, this is a great conversation. I just wanted to acknowledge that I thought you made a really remarkable speech.
Oh, thank you.
And something, and I love the fact that you made John Ruskin's words relevant and citing them. Yeah. And you mentioned Sir Ken Robinson, and you mentioned
he's a great speaker.
There are these really great minds. And you also mentioned edification. And it just struck me. I had a conversation a while ago with a lawyer friend, and I said a film was edifying. He said, edifying? What word?
Right.
He said, let's look that up, because I don't use it anymore. But, you know, and that got us into a conversation about how German novels of someone's autobiography are called Bildungs. You know, the sense of the building and
development,
edification of an individual. And so I guess for my daughter, I gave her a bill of calendar. And then I felt like that was an edifying thing to do. Her old pioneers and my Antonia. At any rate, do you have recommendations of young adult novels that are good at that notion of self-development?
Well, I think that something like what you have already given her is good. It's tricky because you want the child to enjoy what they're reading, obviously, and you don't know what that might be. But I find that so many of the older traditional children's stories are, you know, even my son sometimes will say, oh, that's old, I don't want to read that. And I'll say, okay, wait a minute, read the first chapter. If you hate it, you don't have to read anymore. And almost always, he's hooked after the first chapter, because these are books that are well written, you know, and just because they might have been written 50, 60, 100 years ago doesn't mean that they're no longer enjoyable to read. Swallows and Amazons was one of them, Arthur Ransom's series. I mean, there's many, many good books. But I think that, exposing children to a wide variety of books is important. And so much of...
It's kind of showing them that kind of scaffolding of a person's development over from childhood to...
Right. Well, and also having them read things that has some challenging language. One of the things that I find, and I mentioned in the talk, is that so many students, and I teach Victorian literature as well, so many students will come to class, and those who are there because they want to study Victorian literature, obviously they're a little less intimidated by it. But I have some students who are taking it as part of what are called cluster courses at PSU. And so it's kind of an interdisciplinary thing. And they tend to be intimidated by the language. You know, why are these sentences quite so long? Couldn't he have stopped a little while back? You know, and so they tend to just kind of distance themselves from it or not become as engaged as they might. And I try to tell them that, you know, this is literature that you have to understand when it was, like Ruskin's books, when they were first published. You know, you go and buy the new Ruskin, that was bang up to the minute. That was the latest book. You were happy to have it. It was new. It was progressive. We tend to think of, you know, literature that was written, say, in Ruskin's time or even 60 years ago as something, an artifact. But it's all living, vital stuff that we can still enjoy. And I think it's important that young people can engage with all kinds of language and not just the language that's spoken on, you know, YouTube or on TV or in the magazines. It's kind of a digression, sorry.
I think you mentioned some things that I'm not sure, perhaps I'd like to know if this was in Ruskin's area as well, but the parent is critical. You mentioned what you have your children. What I had my kids read. And somehow we think that education stops at the schoolhouse door, and it doesn't, in my opinion. I mean, the parents are, it's a three-legged stool. There's a school, there's the student, but there's the parent. And when any of those three legs are missing, the stool falls over.
Right, and that's absolutely true. And I think part of the struggle that the schools are having is that they've had to, in many cases, step in for parents who are not doing that, because there's so many social problems that they're trying to make up for that as well. And so they've taken on a lot of roles that were not traditionally roles that a school would fill. And, you know, they're overburdened in some ways. But that makes it even more important that the sort of education that children are getting is really, you know, of a meaningful and lasting kind. You know, the sorts of education that Ruskin's talking about, you know, leading human souls to what is best and making what is best out of them, teaching people to desire and labor for the things that lead to life. You know, especially if, you know, a school is trying to also fill the parental role, becomes very critical. So, go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for coming and talking to us. It's interesting to kind of think about this. You know, I have a little bit of, I mean, it can be very depressing if you start thinking too much.
Yeah.
But, you know, I kind of have the opposite side. I work in a creative industry, and you know, we see, you know, if you start thinking about the market economy and how the U.S. can compete, the only way they can really compete to a certain extent is because they have to be creative, or they are creative, and it's an idea society. We generate ideas, and we foster creativity, while labor goes seeking cheaper areas. So it's sent to Asia, or wherever it is, and labor looks for its cheapest space. Whereas I think, you know, the thoughts and ideas are really still coming from the United States. And so if you look at, for example, Art Center, which is in Pasadena, nearly, it's growing and growing. They used to have a little building at the top of the hill. Now they own the center of Pasadena.
Right.
One of the largest landowners, property owners in San Francisco, is the art school. And so, you know, it's hard to say that the market economy is a negative force on creativity and generating ideas, when really it can actually foster these things to be competitive in the idea and creativity situation. So I don't know if I'm missing some of your points.
No, I think, I mean, we're not going to get rid of the economy, right? I mean, we have to work with the economy. We, you know, we live in an economy that we have to function with, and obviously, you know, jobs, employment, those are all important things. Making money, we all have to do that. And I think that you know, creativity can't coexist and thrive in the market. But I think that unfortunately, and here too, I mean, in this area, it's a very, you know, creative area. So is the Bay Area, right? I mean, so if you're a student in this area, if you're a young person in this area, you know, you're living in a pretty vibrant, you know, creative kind of place. If you're not in that kind of place, it's a little different experience, I think. So I think it also depends, you know, where you're living, the kind of experience you have, the kind of school you're going to. You know, I don't think that no one is creative anymore. That's not what I meant. But I do think that from what I've seen, you know, and the students that I've talked to, a lot of students who are creative or who would like to develop that part of themselves more feel like they're constrained by expectations. And whether those expectations are, a lot of them are cultural, a lot of them are from the institution that they're at, they feel like they have to follow this. I mean, I have a young person that I know personally who is going to be going into college next year, and he is a creative young man. He's a great photographer, he's excellent with people, he's very artistic, and his mother is a friend of mine, and they're gonna be looking at colleges soon. And I said, oh, you know, what does he think he wants to major in? And she said, finance. I said, what? She said, I know, maybe he'll change his mind. And I said, okay, I said, but why? Because it was really interesting to me, because I'm thinking about these things, I'm writing this talk and thinking about it. And she said, well, he just thinks that's how he's gonna make the most money. And I mean, that's just one case study from my own life, but I hear this kind of thing from students an awful lot, that they feel like they have to follow that kind of a track in order to make a lot of money. Now, what you're saying is actually probably a hopeful thing, that no, you can actually do well and be creative. And I think students need to hear that message more. If it is happening out there, and if people are making a living, you know, being creative and are being fulfilled in doing that, then maybe we need to let students know more about that. Let them know it's an option. Show them how to do it. There you go.
Anybody else? Ron.
I hope you will forgive me, Sara, for asking an unfair and presumptuous question. At my age, I'm the age of Ruskin was, became rather pessimistic.
Mm-hmm.
Both very good ideas and some rationalizations of the present situation. And I don't mean to diminish the importance of reform and adaptation. But what if the reforms don't work?
Well.
Aren't we possibly looking at a point in which, we forget the word revolution, is perhaps more appropriate than reform? And that we perhaps are at a point where we need, our creativity needs to turn towards something that are really new and radical new forms of relationships rather than this attempt over 100 years to repair what we have. If that's so, what would that mean for education? Oh. We need to start our own schools? That's the unfairness of my question.
Well, I mean, some people have done that. I mean, charter schools are people who decided to start their own schools, not revolutionary in the sense that you're saying. What sort of radical new relations do you mean?
Productive relations.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the way that you work creatively. I worked in Hollywood for many years and I taught here at the mm-hmm. cinema school. I would say that's not the way to do it.
Okay.
If you want creative work, you've got to create based on the principles that Ruskin talks about, not about money.
Right.
And I don't think the two really converge very well at all.
I think the hard part, I don't think this is going to answer your question, but it's just something that made me think about, is that students are so programmed today, or young people are so programmed today, to try and find a career that will where they will make a lot of money, not just a living, but generally a lot of money is what I hear, that it's a mindset that you have to change. And that, as I said in just earlier, it's the hardest thing to do. I mean, we seem to have become so mired in this mindset. And I'm not sure how you shift, you know, as you said, Elena, I'm not sure how you shift out of that. I think that a lot of young people are getting tired of the status quo. I see even in movements like urban agriculture and the sharing economy and the makers movement and things like that. I mean, those are all movements that, you know, people have taken upon themselves, and they've come together because they care about, you know, in the makers movement, making things and doing things differently. Just yesterday, Jim, we were talking with students, and you know, Jim had said to them, "Well, a lot of this comes from, you know, personal choice. You know, you have to realize that you have a choice in what you do, and you don't have to follow the status quo. You can do things differently. You know, if we all sit back and say it's never going to change, then it won't. But I think more and more people are trying to do things differently. I mean, don't you see that in culture? I think that there are a lot of new attempts at different sort of relationships already. I don't know about a revolution.
Yes, in the back, please.
So outside of school, you mean? Well, I think there's a lot that can happen outside of school and does, but you know, when if you're doing it outside of school, if you're a young child and you're relying on a parent to facilitate that for you or find it for you, set it up for you, and you know, we've said before that some parents are greatly involved, but others are not. And you know, also, if it's all going to happen outside of school, then why are we going to school? I think that if children are going to go to school for 6 to 7 hours a day, then of course, yes, you're learning all the time, and you're learning at home, and you're learning with your parents and all the time. But if you're going to be in a school building for 6 to 7 hours a day, then some pretty good things should be happening there, I think. I don't think you should have to be there for 6 or 7 hours and then go somewhere else to get the really meaningful parts of your education. Mm-hmm. I think it's good and bad. It's a blessing and a curse, the internet. And I think technology in the classroom is the same. There's strengths to it, and then there's also, you know, there's weaknesses. I think that we've kind of jumped into technology in the classroom and said, technology is great, let's use it across the board, without really thinking about what some of the repercussions might be down the road. But I think human beings tend to do that anyway, just say, this is great, let's do it, without thinking too far down the road. So we'll see how technology in the classroom pans out. I have a friend back in Arizona who was teaching first grade and it was a new job, and she was put into a classroom that was an all iPad classroom. That's what they used. Everything was on the iPad. She didn't like it, and the next year she said she wanted to teach in a traditional classroom. But there's many classes that are adopting that kind of thing now.
So this is a great, great discussion. One more? Anybody else? Well, shall we do one more?
Yes. We've talked at length about the mindset of the students buying into the market economy. And you pointed out there are charter schools and private schools where that kind of enterprise doesn't operate.
Mm-hmm.
It seems that the governments, the state and federal governments, are forcing that mindset on teachers.
Mm-hmm.
They don't really have a choice if they want to keep their jobs.
Mm-hmm.
But at most universities, the faculty really have a choice. My view of my colleagues is they have bought into the market economy of education even more than their students, where the idea is that classes aren't teaching the students to understand and comprehend the content. It's a competitive comparison of how well they do in exams and performance.
Mm-hmm.
And a class isn't an experience and understanding. It's a Marine Corps drill camp. You shove as much crap at them as you possibly can and try to get them to swallow
see what
it
sticks.
All, and then compete with one another. So I'm very curious to hear if there are two or three principles you would recommend to a university faculty member to enrich the experience of education in the course. What would you not do to encourage the students to really engage the content? Those 10 significant pages, as Ruskin suggests.
Well, I mean, I think what's very important in my discipline, at least, which is literature, is discussion. And we discuss all the time in my class. Now, sometimes it's just me discussing, depending on the class and you know how cohesive they are, and sometimes they don't want to talk. Now, this last term at PSU, we had a great deal of discussion, and the students actually really seemed to enjoy it and said, we don't get to do this that often. I think collaborative work in classes is great. And I also think, and we talked about this yesterday, that bringing in creative, active work into a classroom is good. I mean, yesterday my talk was on handwork in education. And I said in that talk that in the primary stages of education, we tend to encourage that, young children, you know, making things, doing things. And as you get older, you do less and less of it. And then by the time you're in university, you're doing almost none. And someone in the audience said, well, how can we bring that kind of thing into university work? And I said, well, I think you can do it in every class. If you're, you know, in the back there, you were talking about being imaginative and creative. I mean, we can apply that to our classes in the university as well. I mean, we can get our students to do things, you know, where they're moving around or they're working with their hands. Even if it is a class where it doesn't seem that it would apply, I teach literature and writing. I've had my students draw in my class. I've taken them to the community garden, and we sit and we've actually done work there too, where we're hoeing and planting. And I think in the beginning they thought I was crazy, but then we write about it. So there, it applies to what we're doing. But we're getting outside. We're getting around. We're moving. We're doing things with our hands. I think getting students excited about what they're learning and trying to get their thoughts away from the grades, because they're so, and someone else mentioned this as well, so focused on grades and outcomes. Not that that's not important, but what you do in the class and what you take from it is important too. I like to tell them that if they leave university and they haven't been changed and challenged in some way, then it hasn't succeeded. And I think a lot of students don't go in looking for that anymore, because it's become kind of a rote performance to go to university. I would just say, though, that I don't think that students have bought in to that mentality. I think they just have been conditioned to it. Because when you talk to a lot of them, they don't agree with it, and they don't like it. It's just what they know. So.
Well, we thank you all for wonderful questions, and we thank Sara for a wonderful time.
And thank you for coming very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Sara, so much.
Thank you.
This enlightening presentation, and even more so for the discussion, because this is what this is all about. If you'd like to continue having discussions like this through the rest of the year, Ruskin Art Club membership materials, not to do a hard sell, but Ruskin Art Club membership materials are here, and our membership chair and PTAC will be
Right,
we'll pursue you forever and also answer all your questions. So there's a membership application form, and this is really what we do. Various kinds of presentations, discussions, including not only discussions about issues, but what are we gonna do with Ruskin's many, many, many challenges to the way we live. Ron was saying earlier. So lots of different activities, lectures, readings, presentations, special events, social events throughout the year. So
concerts,
all sorts of things. So let me tell you just a couple of things that are coming up for the Ruskin Art Club. In October, October 9th and October 23rd, we have book launches for several of our members and friends and associates. Stephen Yenser on October 9th at the Craft and Folk Art Museum, a book launch of his new volume of poetry, the distinguished poet Stephen Yenser, his book Stone Fruit. And we'll be having a reading at 5 p.m. at the Craft and Folk Art Museum on Wilshire Boulevard. On the 23rd, our beloved Elena has a book launch of her new book, Squander, also at the Craft and Folk Art Museum, I think at 2. At 2 p.m. So those are events in October. We're very happy in January 22nd, the evening of January 22nd, at Mount St. Mary's University to be welcoming Robert Pinsky, the distinguished former poet laureate in the United States, will be coming to give us a lecture on Ruskin and Marianne Moore, which we're very, very much looking forward to. And something even more challenging coming up in Saturday, February 18th, we're launching a new element in our life we call the Ruskin Circle, which wants to even get a bit deeper into this area of contemporary issues and Ruskin. So on February 18th, the Ruskin Circle will be meeting at Mount St. Mary's University to discuss the question, who are the poor? And to have a marvelous opportunity under the guidance of our president, Ron Austin, to take a look at Kent McKenzie's film, The Exiles. A remarkable documentary film about Los Angeles and the poor. So this could be a very exciting discussion coming out of that event. So these are a whole variety of things that we do throughout the year that we would encourage you to join us in. So membership material here. Also, I wanted to note that Sara has brought flyers for her book, Ruskin's Educational Ideals, and those are also on the table. The second table here is our books and materials from the Guild of St. George. We're working very, very closely with the Guild of St. George in the UK, Ruskin's charity that he founded in 1872. So we have a number of books there, including an essay by Sarah, two essays by Sara Atwood, one on environmentalism and one on the enormous difference between knowledge and education, what Ruskin can teach us. Also, just a note, as I said before, the Ruskin lecture of last year, given by Clive Wilmer, on Ruskin's language. We were talking earlier about the difficulty sometimes of penetrating the richness of Ruskin's language. Clive gave, I think, a remarkable address on looking at that question and overcoming that hurdle on Ruskin's language, how a Victorian prophet uses words. These are also available for the first time tonight. So I would encourage you to take advantage of all of those things, and we hope to see you. Thank you.